Hello, I'm George Wiseman, and I'm going to make a quick and dirty video of how to take the parts out of the box and put them together into a full ER50. People have been asking for some sort of video representation, and I understand it's easier to see something done than it is to imagine it from diagrams and pictures and the instructions. This box may look different than what you got if you got a previous version or if you get a later version, but the principles are pretty much the same. So, this ER50 is maximized or optimized for health purposes, so this is the tower cap, and it's pretty much done for you. These are the two white pipes that you'll use to cut spacer rings out of, and the spacer rings will look like this. So you just follow the instructions, make them the correct width, which this is just over a quarter of an inch for this particular kit. 9/32, and about, I think it's an inch and a half cut out of the top here.
It helps when you're cutting the rings, using a chop saw like this, or a miter saw, to put a block in front of the pipe as well as the fence behind it. This helps prevent the rings from shooting off into the distance.
Top here. You want, when it's compressed, to actually end up with a gap at the top. You don't want it to come where it's clean at the top. You want there actually to be a gap. We'll get into that a little bit later. So anyway, there's the two white pipes to cut your rings out of. Here's the T assembly, which is already done for you. In the fully assembled versions, I sometimes have a taller tower here, but it really isn't an issue when you put the cap on and you've got this long tower thing happening there, so it's just as fine. I have to have a slightly smaller one when I put them in these boxes, or else, of course, it won't fit. But when I put them in the fully assembled version, then I have a full-size crate, and I can actually increase that a little. So that's one benefit you get from having the fully assembled version. Okay, that again, that's pretty much done. We'll get back to that a little later as we put things in. Down here we have the pressure relief tubes. We'll get into those. And inside these we have all the plates inside this particular tube. And inside this one we've got the various fittings and stuff that are going to be needed. And we have the lye, which, if you got lye, it's a bonus. I don't list it as the thing that comes with the kit, but if you got it, there it is. And that's all the lye you need. So now we have an empty box. To get into the actual assembly, the first thing I would do is actually glue the... Oh, we don't quite have an empty box. Sorry about that. You got the barbell thing. So the first thing you do is bend the barbell correctly, and I'm just going to grab my pliers off my belt here. What I do is go just beyond, like, see where the angle is there? So you go just beyond that, so when you bend, you can get a nice 90 degree bend. And the same thing on the other side, only you bend it where the tabs, there's a couple of little tabs there. You make sure that they, see if I can show it a little bit better. You want to bend it at the end of the tabs so you actually have these flanges hanging down. So again, we go just beyond the flanges so that there's room for it to actually bend. And give it a bend. Kind of straighten out a little bit. Now what I like to do is actually bend this a little bit like that for when I'm sliding it into the T. And we grab the T, and it doesn't really matter if you go this way or this way, it's the same. You will note that this particular side here is, without the flanges, is smaller. So that means it can slide right through. Pretty much. You see, it's got to just kind of catch on the lips there and stuff. And the flanges will fit pretty tight on this side. Over here, it helps to actually have a little bit of something to catch that hole with, so you can kind of bend it and it goes through like that. So that's good. Done. So the flanges on this side are nice and tight. And you want the gap for the neutral zone bar to be on the bottom. That gives space in case you ever want it in here for the float switch upgrade. So, and make sure that the plate is nicely set and organized there. And we're good to go. Okay, now the next thing to do is to glue down here just so it holds everything in place for when you're sliding the tubes in. And I usually use JB Weld PVC or plastic glue, but I believe it would be possible to do a fair job with just PVC glue, which then you don't have to buy an extra glue. So we'll just take regular PVC glue. I happen to prefer the clear, but it'll any color will work just fine. And I just take a stick in there and dip it in and get myself a good glob on the end of the stick. And then I'll just going to set this down so I have hands free. And then I will put that glob right down on the bottom of the plate there, just right in there, kind of fill in that hole, but get as little on the plate as possible. Although up there just a little bit isn't a problem because the pipe goes in there anyway. That isn't a surface that has that's electrically active. Only right here in the middle, the inch and a quarter in the middle, is electrically active, essentially between these holes kind of thing. Otherwise, there's a pipe down there. So now we'll just let that glue harden. And what that'll do is when I slide the pipes in, the cell tube pipes, when I slide them in, it won't allow the neutral zone to twist and go out of register. So, also notice that in this particular version, I'm just using white tubes as the cell tubes instead of transparent tubes like in previous versions. The previous versions are nice because you can see right through and you can see the Brown's gas being developed and you can see the electrically expanded water and stuff. But over time, especially when you're running these machines a lot, this transparent tube just clouds anyway and goes translucent, so you can't really see in there anyhow. It has a lower temperature rating, so if you want to run for longer periods of time or with higher amperage, it isn't a good plastic to use. But so I simply made it that we just use the regular white plastic and white end caps, and we put the plates in the end, and away we go. Something that's a lot more durable over a period of time. So now we'll stuff the tubes. We have the hole here, which I've made a little mark here so that I can tell what the top is. We have the rings, which we've cut to the right size and made the notch or the gap at the top. We have a roll of tape which will protect the bolt while we're pushing on it. I usually do this in my lap where I can hold it a little easier, but we'll make do here. We put in a ring first, lining up the gap at the top with the top there. I've made a plunger out of the 2x2. Just simply take a 2x2 and cut the edges off a little bit. On this particular one, because I do a lot of plunging, I put a steel round circle on the top, and I have a little screw at the back so that if I need to adjust a ring once it's down in there, I can do that. But in the meantime, that's just a plunger. It doesn't have to be anything expensive. And push down the ring. Okay. Now, the next thing is to put in plates. So we take the plates, we count out 20, because you want 20 in each tube. So you'll know you have 20 when you reach the end of the stack. There we go, two stacks of 20. This will be the stack we'll put in here. Now this particular plate has a rounded edge and a sharper edge, because with it stamped, it causes that to happen. It doesn't matter if you put which way you put it, this way or this way. This particular plate design is designed to have the small flat edge at the bottom, the two holes at the bottom, and the larger flat edge at the top. So we just drop it in there, and then we take our long metal rod, and which I've sharpened the end of this one so I can use it as a adjustment tool, and we adjust it so that the flat edge is at the top down there, just like that. And then we put in the next ring. Nope. Now we do a little special thing called gluing on the bottom. What we do is that small flat edge on the bottom, we take a little glob of PVC glue. I just use the regular transparent PVC glue that I use for everything else. And you put it right on the pipe, just ahead, just a little tiny bit, just ahead of the bottom there. Because what's going to happen is that glue, once it dries, will prevent the plate from turning. One problem we had in early versions of the ER50s is the plates could gradually turn like this, and then the gas couldn't escape from the cells very easily. So by putting a little dab of glue down here, it forms a little flat spot so the plates can't turn. Just a simple little fix for that problem that we had. And then we put in the next ring. And you can see on the bottom there, hopefully, that the glue has come up just a little bit past. So I even put a little bit too much glue in there. Not that it really makes a difference in this particular case, but my point is that you don't need very much to fill that tiny little gap down there at the bottom. So then we put in another plate, and we lined it up. With the other one, and with the top there, perfect. And then we put in another ring. No, we don't put in another ring. We have to glue it first. But I'm going to put another ring in anyway, because there's something I want to show you. And so we put this ring in without gluing it, and then we go, oh, darn, we didn't glue it. All right. So what I did is I made myself out of another metal rod. You just bend this over, pounded it on the anvil, made a little flat tapered part there so that I actually could put it down in there. It's got a little angle over here. This is actually out of a bucket handle, so it has. And just reach down there and grab that ring and pull it right back out. Okay. Alright. Now we make sure our plate is in and down. Ah, and that's one thing too, is after you put in each ring, just make sure your plate is all the way down. Sometimes the plates get moved upward a little bit, and you want it all the way down against the bottom. Okay, so we'll put in another little dab here. And the ring. Plunge it down. Put in a plate. Make sure all the plates are down. Previous one. Lined it up. A dab of PVC glue on the pipe itself, because the next ring will just kind of push that down into place, and then it gets the minimum amount that on the plates. Okay, got the glue in there. Put in the ring. Put sure the plate, I could see that one moved up a little bit, so just make sure it's all the way down, and it is. And the next plate. This is where that little pointy thing comes in nice, because you can use it to get into the holes there. Okay, line up the plate. So it looks nice and lined up down there. A little dab of glue on the pipe just before the plate. Next ring. Particular case, the plate has gone misaligned, so we will realign it there. Again, that's where a tapered helps, because you just kind of push it right in there. Okay, looks good. Now that you can see, the ring isn't lined up perfectly either, but that's fine. This is fine. The rings don't have to be perfect. Anywhere in that range is just fine. Okay, I'll be back once we've filled the tubes. Okay, I'm back, just having finished stuffing these tubes. Now, normally, what would happen, there's 20 plates and ring and 21 rings in each of these. You start with a ring and you end with a ring, so there's always one more ring than there is plates. And you can see there's some left over. Now, normally what you'd do if you only had 20 plates is you would cut off the tube with the fine-toothed saw and flush with the edge of the last ring. But another thing you can do, and what I do, because I have extra plates, is I just put in three more plates so it comes out flush when I'm building the fully assembled unit, which this will end up being for customers that want the fully assembled one. So it'll end up, instead of 40 cells, it'll end up being 46 cells. And you can go up to 50 cells with 110 or 120 volts AC input. It doesn't matter that there's fewer cells. It'll still make at 50 liters an hour, which is the ER50 specification. If you put in a few more cells, it'll make a little bit more gas. And so that's just another bonus that you get when you buy a fully assembled unit. Or when you're building your own, you can make your own plates and build out those plates. Eventually, I'll sell the extra plates, too, on the website if people want to do that. But it's fine to use the 40 plates. That's what it's specified for. I'm just saying, if you have extra tube, you can make extra plates up to 25 per side, which would be 50 total. And you don't want to go over that, because then you actually get gas reduction, because the voltage, the total voltage required to push the amperage through the electrolyzer is greater than the voltage being provided at the wall. So I'll put in those extra plates, and then we'll go to the next step. So we're back again with fully stuffed tubes and some PVC cement and PVC primer. And in this case, we're going to glue them into the T, starting with the side that has the flanges on. Not the side that slide through, but the side you glued right there. So first, some solvent, then some glue. Get that all ready. Put a little piece of cardboard to glue on and stuff, so don't get drips on the table. Not that it doesn't, it does actually clean off fairly easily, so that's not a problem. In the end, what we want is for this hole to be up so that it matches the same as this hole over here. So we got, it'll end up like that in the end. Okay, and we'll glue this side first with the flange in there so everything holds in solid. So I'm just going to kind of hold everything together here, doing it in a way that can be seen in the camera. So a little bit of solvent, PVC solvent, around the outside of the pipe, approximately the distance that it'll be for the glue. Making sure it's nice and well contact there. And then we go with the glue. Getting it so it won't drip so much. And I put it on here first to kind of use up some of the glue. Make a medium. You don't want it too thick. You don't want it too thin. And then on the inside here, making sure not to touch the plate. You don't want any glue, PVC glue, on the plate itself, because that will, the primer is not a problem. The glue, you don't want it on there. Now we have to do this fairly quickly because that glue is already starting to dry. And I start with the hole on the bottom, turning it as I slightly push it in till we reach 180 degrees, and then make sure that it's fully down, fully pressed down. Hold for 10 seconds at least. Because that prevents the compression that's in here from popping the tube back out. So here we have the hole on the top, lining up with the hole on the top there. We have one side done. Now, a reason we have this roll of tape again is because when we go to press on the next one, we'll put that screw into the roll of tape. Okay, so same thing again. We put the, make it nice and wet with the solvent. The solvent cleans and prepares the surface for the glue so that the glue binds better. And we make it on there. I like to use transparent PVC glue and solvent because it makes a nice neat finish. So we'll put the glue on an even coating, and then again an even coating, and again starting at 180 degrees off, get it inserted, and then spin it as it goes in. The reason for the spinning is because that eliminates the air bubbles. If you just push the pipe straight in, there's any air bubble will form a pocket, essentially, that will have no glue on it from one side to the other, and the seal will leak. By spinning it as you go in, you cause the glue to mash all the air bubbles out. So actually, the farther you spin it, the better. I used to do it only 90 degrees, but now I do it 180. And I don't finish pushing it all the way in until I do all the turning, 180 degree turning, about 3/4 of the way in, and then I kind of push the last little bit in. A lot of these pipes, if you try to do it 180 degrees, pushing it fully in at that time, it'll lock up because there's a slight taper in the fittings here. These fittings actually have a slight taper, so the farther you push in, the more it binds. So you want to make sure to get all that turning done before you push it all the way in. So there we go. An assembled ER50. And I'll come back. We got to put the pipes on here. So in this particular case, again, I was recommending that you can use epoxy, plastic epoxy, on the threads of the little nipples here, the pipe fittings. And you can do that, but another good way to do it is just with the Teflon tape. Just put Teflon tape on the threads and thread them in. That will work really well. Or you could do the PVC glue again, where you just put some PVC glue on there and screw them in. Any of those three methods will work just fine. Of the three methods, my preference probably at this time is just the Teflon tape, because it makes it easy to take the fittings out whenever and if ever you want to, and put on more Teflon tape and put them in again. That causes the, if they ever leak, you can just take them out and put them in. Now, the PVC glue and the epoxy can do that as well. It's just not as neat, because taking the glue and stuff off the pipe fittings is a little harder. But that does they can be unscrewed and resealed if they ever happen to leak, which generally they don't with these smaller pipe fittings. I've tried larger pipe fittings, and because the plastic, this high-density polyethylene, tends to have a different expansion and contraction rate when it's heated than the PVC, it will eventually cause a leak if you have fittings that are threads that are too large. Like instead of using 8-inch National Pipe tapered threads here, if you were to use like 5/8 National Pipe tapered threads. So we go ahead and screw these in. Obviously, I'm just starting the threads here. Making sure the threads are going in properly and not getting cross-threaded or something. And then I happen to, just on a keychain, have a small crescent wrench, but you can use a proper box end as well. And they don't have to be extraordinarily tight. When you have the Teflon tape, it seals really, really well. And these particular type of fittings are actually tapered, so the farther you put in them, the farther you screw them in, the tighter they fit. So there we go. So we have all those in place. Put that back in my pocket. And we bring out the pressure relief tubes. So we push those on. Make sure to push straight because you don't want to push in an angle and actually break off the little nipple. And then we make a nice curve up to the nipple there. So that means I've got this much extra to cut off. Some people make the curve go way up like that. I don't really see where that's necessary. I like to keep it neat. And grab my knife off my belt. Do a quick little cut there. Make this one nice and neat. Quick little cut there. And slide those on. Now for the time being that would probably work just fine, but because when it heats up the pressure might tend to push it off, I include these nifty little plastic clamps which are designed to hold plastic pipe nicely. And we can just put two on that side and two on this side. And give them a little bit of a start. And then grab a pair of pliers that can reach over it far enough, kind of center it there, and give it a squeeze. And if you need to, just make it neat. You'll see it's slightly out of register there, so I just put it into register. Okay, so that is a fully assembled ER50, again with the Teflon tape. You put 4 to 7 wraps around. First wrap, you kind of have to hold that end. Two, three, four, five. And that pretty much is it. I thought I'd take a quick segue to show you a little tip. A lot of you probably already know this, but for those that don't, this is very important. When you are wrapping the Teflon tape, always wrap it in the direction of the threads as if you're going to be screwing something on. So in this particular case, we would be wrapping the Teflon tape this way, because it'd be the same as if you're screwing it into the threads. And this particular threads, I put about 5 wraps of Teflon, 5-6, and so that makes it so that when you're putting the cap on, it screws the Teflon tape into the threads. If you wrap the Teflon tape the other way, when you're putting the cap on, it will tend to turn the tape out of the threads and actually gouge it out of the threads. Whereas if you put it this way, it turns the tape, when you put it this way, it turns the tape into the threads and actually seats them in the threads. So when you have a cap like that, which has the threads, then when you're turning it in, it will turn into the threads and seal. And you only have to make it hand tight to seal. Whereas if you put the Teflon tape the other way, it'll turn out. Okay, and similarly with even the little fittings. Again, you put them in, and I like to hold the tape in this way, like so. You put it in as if you're screwing in the fittings. Okay, left to open, right to close. So you'll be closing the fittings in this way. So I put the tape on. Hold it there with my finger, and then roll the tape into the threads. Okay, I was pulling a little hard on it there. I like to get the tape right into the threads. Okay, here we go. Make it nice and wide. But again, the main thing I'm showing is that I'm turning the fitting in the same direction as if I was screwing it into the hole. Okay, clockwise in this case. Okay, 2 wraps is plenty for these little fittings. So, there you go. It'll turn into, and it'll actually tighten the Teflon tape into the threads. Whereas if you put the Teflon tape on the other way, it would actually just spin the Teflon tape right out of the threads. Obviously, you wouldn't get a seal then. So, little tip. So the next thing is to build a crate. So here we have an ER50 shipping crate, which I've also designed to be an ER50 stand. Generally speaking, you'll see that the screws, now on the back of the newest ones, I just staple the back and what have you, but in these older ones, I actually had screws. And I use a Robertson head, which is a square head, number 2 Robertson head screwdriver, to screw the screws into place. And so we've got essentially half-inch plywood box, which is the shipping crate, that we can now assemble an ER50 right into. So we take our newly assembled ER50 and we set it in the box, line it up with that hole here because that's where the tower for the cap, gas cap and stuff will go, and then we will install the switch arrangement, which in this particular case I usually handy having tools on your belt. Into these holes just to keep the wires from getting damaged. You can use metal, plastic, doesn't really matter. And I'll go in there like that. Let's see. Yeah. Go in there like that. And the full wavebridge rectifier I will set in there like this. And that all should work just fine. There we go. The screw I'll use to hold the full wavebridge rectifier in place. In this case I'm going to use a 7/64 inch screw bit. So notice that I'm keeping the cutoff corner, the corner that's beveled there, which is the positive, up in the upper left-hand corner. That's just my own way I do things, so that I can always identify the positive terminal. Because this one on the opposite side, directly opposite, is the negative terminal, and then these two are the AC. So if I know where the positive is, I always know where everything else is. So we put that on there. An appropriate screw. And we screw that in place, which incidentally holds the box in place as well at the moment. But we can also toss another screw or two into the box there to hold it in place as well. Okay, all that's in place, and now the capacitors, which incidentally I didn't show you when we were originally taking the box apart. The capacitors would normally be stuffed into one of the long white tubes like so. So then you would pull them out. So the capacitors, we mount those here. Keeping this lined up with this hole in the center here. And I usually mount the capacitors with what's called plumber's tape. In this case I'm using copper plumber's tape, but you can use steel or zinc-coated iron or anything that happens to be available. The idea is to put all of the components in place before you start the wiring process, so then your wires are going to be exactly where you want them to be. Now, if you had a little more room, you could actually put this tape down between them and then up around again, but this works just fine as well. And before I make it right tight, make sure my capacitors are how I want them to be. Okay, everything is now solid. All good. This is one of the nice things. If a person has a little taller tower piece, all of this would be up a little further, so the hoses wouldn't be quite so cramped in here. Or when you're putting in the hoses, sometimes it's good to then, like I said, make a nice neat curve. Well, if you made the curve go up a little more again, it wouldn't be quite so cramped in there. But that's all just because of this little bit shorter tower. If the tower is taller, then you have lots of room for the switches and stuff in this particular arrangement. I'm actually looking at trying to compact everything as much as possible, because then maybe I'll be able to shrink the size of the crate and actually reduce the materials cost, the size when you're packing it around, and the shipping costs. Alright, the next step is the switch. Now, this particular timer switch is the one I prefer. It has 30 minute, 15 minute, 10 minute, 5 minute. You can actually get it so it has an hour instead of 30 minutes. And actually, in my personal machines, I tend to do that because I tend to sit and work on the computer for longer than an hour at a time, so I just have the timer go for an hour. But on machines I build for other people, I just use the 30 minute timer. Which, if you're just charging water, for example, 10 minutes is fine. You just push the 10 minute button and it'll go for 10 minutes. So I don't bother looking at the instructions or wiring diagram, because I've done dozens of these and I know what it is. The white will go to neutral, the black will go to power, the green will go to ground, which in this case also goes to the box. Yellow, don't even worry about, it's for application if you have more than one timer in series. And the red goes to the load, so the power comes in through the black and goes out through the red. So this is the cover that'll go on here. Let's put the wires. Let's put the cover in place. Okay. I want it in such a way as to keep the switch as far as possible to the left, giving myself as much room as possible over here for the full wave bridge rectifier. Now, we'll have one of the round terminal ends for each side. We'll have my little kit here. The two nuts. So according to the wiring color code, we'll put a red out to this terminal. Now, in a flat plate electrolyzer, it really doesn't matter if you go positive on this side and negative on this side, or positive on this side and negative on this side. On what I call the grid plate electrolyzers, it does make a difference, but just for convenience sake, we're going to put the positive out here to this side. Okay, positive to there. And then, when we bring it in here, we make sure we have enough room in order to bring the positive terminal to there. And the side cutters, cut that off. Take this terminal end, which has a round ring on it. There. Cut it tight. Take one of these quarter-inch tab terminal ends. There, crimp it up tight. And that goes on the positive terminal. And then out here. Goes on the positive terminal. Now, this is very important. When you are tightening this nut on the end here, you have to make sure that the inner nut does not turn. Does not turn. If that inner nut turns, there's a really good chance that you'll break the seal inside the cap and electrolyte will start leaking out this terminal end. So the way to prevent it from turning is to hold on to this terminal end so it doesn't turn. Let's see if I can get this a little clearer in the camera here. So, what we're doing is holding on to this terminal end so it does not turn, and then we're tightening the nut, stainless steel nut, and we're making very, very certain that this terminal end does not turn. The nut has to slide on it, and we make it reasonably tight. Don't really need to break it or anything. And then everything is nice and tight, but that inner nut there did not turn. You don't ever want that inner nut to turn. Okay. Now I'm seeing things moving here, so one of the things we haven't done yet and need to do is actually clamp the electrolyzer in place. So again, we get our thermostatic. Appropriate screws. I use pan head two Robertson. Here we go. And then we'll screw that down there. And determine how much tape I need. There. Not going to move. Everything is solid. Now you may have to loosen off one or both of these screws when you go to put the gas cap on, but we'll worry about that when the time comes. Okay, so to continue our wiring, we have the positive here. So next we'll do the negative, which we'll use black wire. And I like to feed it in behind the electrolyzer. And we'll feed it underneath the capacitors. Again, put the ring terminal on this end. Now I'm using black because DC wiring code, red is positive, black is negative. So again, we put this nut on the end. So we bring the wire back nice and neat. It could have gone this way as well, underneath, but it needed a little bit of room. The wire goes up under here because it needed a little bit of room underneath the electrolyzer. And we bring it over here to go to the negative terminal on the full wave bridge rectifier. Again, using the quarter inch tab. And as I pointed out before, positive up in this corner, negative over on this corner, just opposite, diagonally. So let's put that on there. And we have that in place. Now we wire the capacitors into place. And to do that, we make a couple of jumpers which will jump from capacitor to capacitor. If you want to add more capacitors, you just add more jumpers. And extra capacitors could be mounted over here or over there. It really doesn't matter where they are, just you run the wires to them. Passages. I'll put the back wire in first just because it makes it easier. And then the front wire. The hose is just going right in between the wires there. There we go. The two capacitors hooked up in parallel so that the electricity, when it comes into one side, has to go through the capacitor, both capacitors, to get to the other side. And then back. Okay, so now we'll run a wire to and from the capacitors into the circuit box here. So here's one wire. And we'll make it go over here to there. I'll go there. I like to give the wires a bit of a twist, so when I'm sliding the terminal ends on, they don't have one strand of wire get pushed off to the side. Okay, so that wire connects there. And this wire connects exactly the same on the bottom set of terminals. And we make this nice and neat. This wire will go, let's take it to here. Particular AC terminal, it doesn't matter which one it goes to, but I'm going to take it to there simply because I'm wanting to keep this all open for your visible, what you're visibly going to be seeing. Now this one actually, this wire doesn't go to the other AC terminal. This wire actually goes to the power from the timer switch. It'll be having a Marette. Okay, we're good on that. Now we'll get the extension cord ready. What I've discovered is that you can buy extension cords. You can actually buy cords with plugs on them already, but by the time you buy the cord, the plug, and all of that, you can buy an extension cord, like at Walmart or something, three-prong, relatively inexpensively. But I do get one the length that I want, and cut off the end. I actually leave enough because I use these for other projects. Just kind of give a little snip there in the meantime. Give myself a little bit of slack. This green cord in the middle is the ground. Cut off that little bit of excess wire from cord cover. And expose the wires here. Now, in North America, you'll see that one of the holes is bigger than the other one. The bigger one is the neutral, believe it or not. The little one is the power. this little roundish kind of one up there is the ground. So when you're looking at the plug, in this particular case, they made the both terminals exactly the same size, and the ground obviously is round. So to determine which one is actually the power, which is the one you're going to power go to the switch with, not the neutral, you can just compare the plugs to the holes there. So you know this terminal would go into that bigger hole, so that's the neutral. And then the power goes into that smaller hole, so that would be the power. All right. So keeping an eye on which one that is, I can use a continuity tester. So I set my multimeter up for continuity. So when there's a continuity, it makes a sound, and I go with that positive, or that power, excuse me, and I test which of these wires makes continuity. So I'm seeing that this one is the one that makes continuity, and in this particular case, this is a ribbed wire, and this is a smooth one, so now I know the smooth one is going to be my power wire. That's important, because that's that knowing which one's the power and which one's the neutral, and of course the ground as well, will help you when you're wiring the circuit here to get it correct. It's actually not an emergency or dangerous if you get it the wrong way around if you put the neutral in, but where I say to put the power, but it's safer that when the switch is off, the power is off. The power doesn't go all the way through the machine and then back to the switch and then nothing happens. The power stops at the switch. So, that's the way I like to wire it. So right now I'll just twist all these together to help get them pushed into this outlet. So we have all the wires. Personally, when I'm wiring a circuit, I like to start with the ground. So we'll open the ground circuit on the box. We'll get the ground on the light switch, which is the green wire. Twist the grounds together. And put them on the left side of the screw. The reason being is when they're on the left side, when it turns in, it'll turn the wires into the screw. If you put them on the right side of the screw, it would tend to push the wires out of the screw. So there, it's fully nicely seated in there. Okay. Now, we will put the power to the power on the switch. So we know the power is the smooth wire, not the ribbed wire. Obviously, you can mark it with black tape or something like that. But in this particular case, I know that this is the one. So we'll twist those wires together. And then get a marette. Fasten them permanently. Okay. And then the neutral wires all go together. So this is neutral from the plug and neutral from the switch. We still have to make the neutral coming from the full wave bridge rectifier. What we have currently is the red will go to power going to the capacitors. When the power comes back from the capacitors, it goes into the full wave bridge rectifier. The full wave bridge rectifier puts it into the DC circuit and then brings it back out this terminal here, which will be the terminal going to the neutrals. So we will make ourselves a neutral jumper power back from the neutral. So we have all complete circuits. The complete AC circuit and the complete DC circuit. When I'm going to Moretta wire, I give about 5/8 of room, and when I'm using the terminal ends, then somewhere around 3/8 to maximum a half an inch is all that is needed. So we'll put a terminal end on this end. And that terminal end goes there on the full wave bridge rectifier, the last terminal that's free. Okay, so as I was saying before, I like to actually start with the ground when I'm wiring a circuit. Then I actually like to go to the neutrals, do all the neutrals, and then the power. I actually did the power there already going to the switch, but we'll pretend like I'm just doing the neutral. So we have neutral from the switch, we have neutral from the full wave, from the full wave bridge rectifier, and the neutral to the power, all combining. So that's how power goes back into the circuit. And we'll put a Moretta on that. And then finally we complete the power circuit, which is, we already have power going to the switch, now we have power coming from the switch to the where the capacitors with this circuit right there. So again, this yellow wire means nothing, don't even worry about it in this particular switch, and I'll walk through the circuit. We determined which was the power wire, and which was the ground, the green ground, and which was the neutral. The power went to the black on the timer switch. The neutral goes to the neutral on the timer switch, and to the neutral on the full wave bridge rectifier. And then the power comes off of the timer switch and goes to the capacitors in this wire, and then from the capacitors the power comes back and goes to the other AC terminal on the full wave bridge rectifier. Now, even though we wired the DC circuit first, the full wave bridge rectifier turns AC, which is a sine wave which goes like this, into DC, a full wave DC, so it takes this part of the sine wave and flips it over like this, so now the DC pulses are going like this to the electrolyzer. So those are DC pulses with positive coming out of this part of the full wave bridge rectifier and going over here, and negative coming out of this side of the full wave bridge rectifier and going over to here. So we have positive and negative. So that's all wired. Now it's just a matter of putting all this together in such a way as that the circuit will fit, all the wires will fit in there. And then screw it down. Everything neat, and the electrolyzer is wired. Next thing, putting on the pouring the lye into, and then putting on the cap. So now we're preparing the cap assembly. So this is the cap that goes on the top of the tower. And we're down to our final pieces of stuff in here, in the pack. So we have a tube which will allow us to fill the electrolyzer with water using the syringe. Obviously, we don't need sealed syringes for this particular thing, but that's how they come. So the syringe would squirt the water in, and we have the check valve, which will prevent water that's in the bubbler from coming back into your electrolyzer, and we have a cap, which will put on there to keep the gas from coming out of the water fill. And so we will put the Teflon tape on these fittings first. Again, putting the Teflon tape on just the same way as if you were spinning the fitting into the hole. You don't want the Teflon tape to go over the fitting, and since this is pretty wide tape, that means it actually comes up over the flanges there a little bit, but that's all right. Just fine. You're only ever going to put these things in finger tight anyway. It doesn't matter if they're a little loose. The Teflon tape actually does a really good job of sealing. So in this particular case, I'm going to say this will be the water fill fitting. And we just screw it in there like that. And that's probably enough. It doesn't have to screw in all the way. As soon as you feel a little resistance, that's probably just fine. Just leave it like that. And over here, I'll just screw in the gas out fitting. Again, you do not have to go in any further than that. If you ever had a issue with thinking there might be a leak, you can just put a little bit of soap in water so that when you mix it up and spread it on, it would make a soapy film. And if there's any gas leaking, of course, when the electrolyte is under pressure, obviously, it'll form the bubbles coming out. You'll see the bubbles coming out. So I just leave it like that. Now, I always put a check valve on the gas out. So we just cut ourselves a quick little short piece of quarter-inch vinyl tubing. And so that's 3/8 of an inch outside diameter, 1/4 inch inside diameter. Now, one way will allow the air to blow through and the other way not. I'll just check out. Just blow. Okay. I blew on it. At first I blew this way, then I blew this way. And when I blew this way, it allowed the air to flow through. When I blew on this side, it did not allow the air to blow through. Since I want the gas to come out of the electrolyzer through the check valve, but I don't want any water or anything to go back into the electrolyzer, I go with this side here that allows the air to blow through. I just check again. Yep. Okay. So I'll put that fitting on that side, and then that goes on here. Now, I don't bother to put any clamps on this, because unless this hose gets quite hot, these little ridges will seal it quite nicely without clamps. The only reason I put clamps on the hoses, the pressure relief tube hoses, is because those hoses get quite warm, and then they'll kind of relax, and then they'll allow the pressure to blow out electrolyte solution. But these ones, I've never had a problem just pushing in the fittings like that. So that's the cap assembly ready to screw on. As soon as the electrolyzer dries enough to have no PVC smell, because I don't bother putting the cap on, because I pour the electrolyte directly into the tower big hole, and then I put this on. And then from that time on, you'll only ever put water into this fitting here. So you would pop that off, and you would suck up some pure water, and you would stick it on there and just blow that water right into the electrolyzer. And that's how you refill the electrolyzer with water. Now, for those people that want to go a little bit more and actually fill the electrolyzer while it's running or anything like that, then what you would do is put another check valve like this one over here, only oriented the other way around. So it allows water to go in, but doesn't allow gas pressure to come out. And in that case, I would still use cap to plug the end of the check valve just for backup, because the check valves, quite frankly, don't work 100% of the time. And what will end up happening is, if the check valve is kind of relaxed and allowing a little gas to escape, when you turn on the electrolyzer and you didn't have a cap on the end, it would allow gas to flow out past the check valve and it wouldn't build any pressure and you wouldn't get any gas out the hose you actually want to get gas out. So I'm just saying, if you put a check valve in there, it allows you to fill the electrolyzer with water while it's actually under pressure. It never gets not pressure. And I do that on my personal machines, but since it's an option, I don't actually include it in the for sale machines. The ER50 resources tells you where you can get these check valves on eBay and stuff. You just look for quarter inch KNR HHO check valves and they'll be fine. Okay. The vinyl hose, this is more of it. What you would do then is hook that up to that and go, you could either put an airstone on the end of that and bubble in water, or you can hook this up to hoses that go to bags if you're bagging your arm or suction cups or whatever you're doing to treat with directly with the gas. Or you can run this to a bubbler, which then in the bubbler you can make bubbled water to drink, or the bubbler cleans the gas. It's called scrubbing the gas. If there happens to be any lime mist, one of the reasons we have such a tall tower here is because, and that's why it's optimized for health conditions, is because when the Brown's gas is being generated, it's a water vapor and moisture and stuff that is coming out with the gas, and some of that water actual vapor can have little tiny bits of lye attached to it, and we're talking microscopic, like just not hardly a measurable trace even with really good equipment. But it's enough that if you get it in your lungs or the back of your throat or something, you'll feel it. So you don't want to breathe the gas directly. You want to run it through a bubbler, and that water in the bubbler will grab all those lye molecules, and the gas that's coming out then is breathable and pure. So that's what you would hook up to your nose cannula, as you can see with other videos that I have. There we go. Enjoy. Actually, I was just now setting up this check valve on my own personal one here, and one of the things that you'll note is that the end of the fitting here, the lure fitting of the syringe, won't quite fit into the check valve. So what I've done in the past is simply put on another hose and fitting, a barb fitting, tube-to-tube coupler. But in this particular case, I decided what I'll do is I'll just drill out that fitting just a little bit. So I took a 5/32 drill bit and just drilled out the fitting very carefully, a little bit, going in like a quarter inch or so, and making sure that all the bits of plastic came out this direction. And now the syringe fits quite neatly into that check valve for when I'm filling it up with water, without having to add another length of hose and stuff like that. So I'll put that cap on there. And there we go. Enjoy. So here we have about 3/4 of a quart, or about 750 milliliters of water, pure distilled water. And we have our bottle of lye. And this is best done in a well-ventilated area. I use just a stainless steel knife and glass jar. You put in a few dribbles of the lye crystals, and then just start mixing. And have patience. The lye will dissolve into the water. And as the water warms up, due to the chemical action of the lye going into solution, it'll actually absorb the lye crystals quicker. And every so often, just pour in a few more lye crystals. And just have patience. Keep mixing. Don't allow the lye to crystals to form a sediment on the bottom of the jar. And gradually, as this is happening, it'll form a little bit of a mist coming off the top. Let's see. And that mist is quite toxic smelling. It's just a byproduct of the lye going into solution. And once the lye is in the solution, there isn't a problem. That mist is gone. It'll be nice and clean gas coming out of the ER50. So you do this at some point previous to when you need it, because it's best to, after you assemble the ER50, you want it to sit for a few days till all the glue smell is gone, the PVC glue smell. You don't want the PVC to smell at all, because that PVC, if it isn't fully cured, it will contaminate the Brown's gas. It'll smell like PVC glue. And that smell just won't go away. It'll just stay and stay and stay. So you absolutely want to have the PVC smell completely gone, which takes about a week or so when you're assembling an ER50. You can actually speed up the process a little bit by leaving the pressure relief tubes off and maybe having a little fan blowing slightly warm, not too warm, air through the electrolyzer to cause it to cure a little faster, because the PVC glue does cure faster when it's warm than when it's cold. But you do want the PVC glue to be completely 100%, no questions asked, cured before you put this lye solution into the electrolyzer. So I'll just keep doing this, and we'll come back when it's time to pour it into the... Okay, the lye is ready. I'm making this video. I'm going to pour the lye in. Now, what I've done is I have almost a full quart, but what you ordinarily would want is about 3/4 of a quart, and you pour in the lye and mix it in and what have you, like before. You're going to have to add a little bit more pure water afterwards. This is just you actually need about a quart to fill the machine entirely. Mm-hmm. But what I do is I mix it with less than a quart of water, because I don't want water splashing out. So then another thing you can do is just make a funnel out of a top of a pop bottle. Makes it easy to make sure that you're not spilling it on anything. And then as you pour, you don't want to pour it all in right at once, because you have to allow time for the liquid to go into the plates and stuff, into the cells. You don't want to pour it so fast that it comes back out the top of the tower. Starting to see liquid come up here. Okay, now I'll get a little bit more fresh water. And what you want here is to have the liquid level come up just above on both sides. In fact, it's just about right where you want it right now. Okay, so we have the liquid level right here at the top of this copper strapping, and that's an excellent spot for it to be. And you can see how high it is up on the two sides there. So not only can you see the machine is level because it's the same height on both sides, but that's the height you want it to be before you start making gas. And you want to always use distilled or deionized water, and deionized only if your deionizer is working correctly. So there's the water off to the side, and then this tower fitting we just put right on top here. And you only have to tighten it down hand tight. The Teflon tape will seal really well. Okay, so I just tighten it up like that, and we're ready to go. This particular electrolyzer, all we have to do now is plug it in and push the start button for whichever amount of time you want. Now, generally, what I do is I set it for 30 minutes because I'm sitting at my computer for longer than 30 minutes anyway. And then I just breathe the gas. You'd hook up the various breathing apparatus, bubbler and breathing apparatus, to this. I like to use bottles like this one for the bubblers because they have a nice wide base and they have enough liquid level in them that then I can take the liquid after it's bubbled and pour it into my various glasses to drink the brown gas bubbled water as well. And so what we would do is we'd look in here, we see that this is the hose that hooks up to the check valve right there. And anytime we want, we can, and then this would hook up to your nose cannulas or another hose to go to bubble or to bag in an arm or anything that you happen to be doing with the Brown's gas. So that would be the Brown's gas cleaned, because the water scrubs any impurities out of the gas if there happens to be a little bit of lye mist, which is one of the reasons we have this tall tower now. It's specifically designed that if there's any lye mist that's being made, it has a chance to settle out down or condense out, and so it's only pretty much the pure gas that's coming out of the top here, but then this bubbler makes sure that it scrubs it entirely. So then we'd fill with pure water anytime we want to. We just fill with pure water in this. We just suck up the pure water or distilled water and just put it right in there. Like that. So now I've put the water in the bubbler. So you can see that the water level comes pretty much to the shoulder here, because you want to have 2 or 3 inches of clear space so that as the gas comes up, it allows the water gas to separate. So you're just getting gas out the tube. And then the tube itself is hooked up to a nose cannula, which just goes in the nostrils normally. And what I like to do is actually just get one of these quarter-inch tubes. It's a relatively stiff, I think it's probably a nylon or something, tube. And when you slide it into the inside of the quarter-inch vinyl hose, it seals quite nicely. And that makes an easy connection that you can take on and off for putting whatever else you're wanting on and off the electrolyzer. And just to reiterate, the hose that comes down, this is gas out, so it goes out through this check valve. The reason we have a check valve here is to prevent the water from coming back up the hose, because the water could go in this filter here and back up the hose and then fill the electrolyzer backwards and making it over full, which we don't want. So what we want to do is have the gas come out this hose, but no liquid come back, so that's why the check valve is here. It allows flow to go this way, but not this way. And the gas comes out and through and down to the bottom of the bubbler, bubbles up through the liquid, and then the gas comes out this hose here to go wherever you're going to do the gas with. Now, I just wanted to show quickly, I actually seal the hoses with silicone on the inside and the outside after having put wire tie to hold the hoses tight so that you have a mechanical tightness, and then I put the silicone on to seal everything. I found that if I just put the hoses through the lid like I had been recommending before, eventually everything gets loose and you have gas leak, and then you don't have the, you're not getting all your bounce gas out your hose. So this particular water here now, after it's bubbled, can be drunk. You can drink it, assuming you put in clear, clean water here, which I do, distilled or deionized, good deionized water. So there's the water and everything. So why don't we just start this up? So here we have the extension cord, and, or rather the power cord for the electrolyzer, and an extension cord which we can plug in. So we plug that in, and we push the button, and we'll be able to see a little bit of liquid rising here, a little bit of liquid rising in the tower, as the gas forces the extra liquid out of the cell tubes, and then and up. So now we have the liquid level rising in the tower to just about here, and we have the gas starting to bubble. So there we go. We have bounce gas being made. A person can now breathe the gas with the cannulas. I'm putting them up over the ears like, whoops. Give myself a little more room. Over the ears like that. And you're breathing the bounce gas. Breathe out through the mouth, in through nose, or just breathe in and out through the nose. But you have to have your mouth closed, or you're not getting your full amount of bounce gas in. So as you can see, it's absolutely clear in the tower, and it should stay that way. You maybe get a little bit of condensation, but that's what this tower is for, is to make sure that everything is as clean, as clear as possible. Now, as we use the gas, about every hour or so of the gas use, you'll need to fill with water. So again, in this particular case, I put a check valve here. So every hour or so, you'll squirt some water in there. And about 10 milliliters per hour. And when you're ready to shut it off, all you do is just either let it run its course in the timer or press the bottom button and it shuts off the gas. The nice thing about the timer is that you'll never run out of liquid. It's very, very important to know that pretty much the only thing that can kill these ER50s is to run out of liquid. That's why I have a timer. Another option would be to put a float switch in so that if the liquid level gets too low, it would shut off the electrolyzer. But that's very expensive to do, and extra added parts and stuff like that. So since it uses very little water, all you have to do is make sure that there's water level, you can see it here in this tower tube, before you turn on the timer switch. Because the timer switch goes for 30 minutes maximum, and that would allow, say, a quarter to 3/8 of an inch drop in liquid level here, so there's absolutely no way you would ever run out of liquid, as long as each time before you turn on the timer, you make sure to look for your liquid level, either in the tower tube or in the side tubes. One trick to make the check valve work properly is to simply put your syringe on it and work it back and forth like this. And then you'll feel, when the check valve starts working properly, you'll feel the suction. Sometimes when they're new, or if they get something in them, they'll not work properly. So anyway, this check valve is now working properly. And another thing I like to do is put a couple of screws so it makes it easy to store the syringe right where you need it.